And so a great big welcome to you on this fifth Sunday of Lent as we gather as God's people. And yes, we are still in our respective homes. And no, we don't know when church is going to reopen, so hang in there. But nonetheless, know that we still are the church. For the church never has been that building, but it's always been the people. And I thank God for each of you, for you are the people of God. Today in our service, the lesson deals with some Greeks coming and they want to see Jesus. So they come up to Philip, one of the disciples, and said, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. I love that phrase, and it's always touched me deeply to know that there are those who yearn to see Jesus. But it's also my prayer that for each of us, we would never stop yearning to see Jesus, to know him in all his fullness, to experience him in the very depths of our hearts. And so I hope today that the message and the service and the music is helpful as we together we continue to grow as the hands and the feet of our Lord. We are his, and I pray that he would continue to guide and direct us in all that he would have us to do. Again, thank you for being a part of us today. And I now turn the service over to our music team as they share the gifts of music. God bless you. So we begin our service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so to you, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so we pause for a few moments of silence and self-examination. And so, most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. And for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. And in the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us of all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, therefore declaring to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, Amen.
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
The first lesson is taken from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors, when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and remember their sin no more.
Psalm 51, verses 1 through 12. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being, therefore teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, You are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek.
Among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and they said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life will lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." Crowds standing there heard it and said it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. And so grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you again that as we gather as your people, and yes, still in respective homes, we thank you for your presence with us. Lord, I ask that you would come. Help us to know how real you truly are, that we truly would see you with the eyes of our hearts. Oh Lord, thank you for your hand upon our lives. And I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleased in your sight. And this I pray. Amen. If you could spend an evening hanging out with a celebrity, who would you want to hang out with? Well, an organization named Charity Buzz is an online auction site that allows people all over the world to bid on exclusive experiences with world-famous celebrities. And all the money raised goes to support various charities. You can bid on a private tour of the Vatican, or a golf game with a professional golfer and caddies, or a behind-the-scenes tour of Conan O'Brien's show with Conan himself as your tour guide. In the past, Charity Buzz has offered exclusive experiences like dinner and courtside tickets to a Dallas Mavericks game with Mark Cuban, or attending a Hollywood movie premiere with Denzel Washington, or a private meeting with soccer superstar Cristiano Ronaldo before one of his games. But what would you do if you actually got to meet your favorite celebrity face to face? Would you be calm and composed about it? Or would you blurt out something embarrassing? Well, a young man, Gareth Dimlow, wrote on Twitter about the time he met Dolly Parton. As she autographed a CD for him, he blurted out, "I've loved you for over 20 years!" In her irrepressible way, Dolly grabbed his hand and said, "Oh, honey, don't stop now." We all hope we could stay calm and composed when we meet our favorite celebrity, yes? We hope we wouldn't do anything too foolish, like not recognize him at all. Well, comedian Ellen DeGeneres convinced soccer superstar David Beckham to pose as a Target employee to surprise his unsuspecting fans. And so Beckham, dressed in the standard red shirt and name tag of a Target employee, stood in the perfume aisle and tried to convince passing customers to buy his new David Beckham cologne. Started up random conversations with passersby, sprayed them with cologne, even made up and sang a really bad little jingle to advertise the new cologne. At one point, a small crowd of shoppers gathers around this to sample the cologne. They're within inches of the world's most famous soccer player, and they never suspect a thing. Well, in today's Bible passage, we see some men from Greece that were seeking to meet Jesus. I wonder if they were nervous about their potential encounter with him. Did they have questions for him? When they met him, did they blurt out something embarrassing? If there had been cell phones in Jesus' day, would they have asked to take a selfie with him? We don't know for sure. But we do know that the Greek culture at that time idolized philosophers about the meaning of life. Yet these Greek men came to a Jewish Passover festival looking for a humble Jewish rabbi named Jesus. What did they hope to find? Jesus was not a philosopher. No one could compare him to Plato or Aristotle. We have nothing that he wrote, and not much of what he said. He did not employ complex sentences or high-sounding ideas. He spoke mostly in parables, and he used the language and the symbols of the common listener. So why is it then that 2,000 years later, we still hang on to his every word? Why is it that hundreds of thousands of brilliant men and women have studied every syllable that was ever recorded of his teachings, and whole libraries of books have been written concerning his impact on human history? It was not what he said. It was who he was. There was something about the very person of Jesus himself that has fascinated people of every generation since he first caused such a commotion in that little region called Galilee. That's why those words first spoken by some Greeks to the disciple Philip are so important to men and women, and young people, and boys and girls today. Sir, we would like to see Jesus. That is the most sincere desire of our hearts. We want to see Jesus. We want to experience him for ourselves. A secondhand report is just not enough. We long to be in his presence. We want to assure ourselves that he's real, that he's relevant, that he is resurrected. We, like Thomas, want to put our hands into his hands and his feet and his side. We want to know him as our Savior and as our friend. We want to see Jesus. And that's part of why we're in worship today. We haven't come to learn the latest political philosophy or to celebrate some dead theology. The hymns are lovely. Atmosphere is as best as it can be since we're limited by our video screens. The prayers are reassuring, but none of us counts for anything if we cannot see Jesus. We would like to see him because something is missing in our lives. Once we had such high hopes, such great dreams, such a fresh sense of Christ's presence in our lives, but time has taken its toll, and there's something missing. We would like to see Jesus. Our lives sometimes seem so tedious, so lacking in vitality, as if we're on a continual treadmill. Most of us think of treadmills as high-end exercise equipment, but did you know that treadmills were originally invented as a form of punishment? Yeah, some of you thinking, yeah, I can believe that. Well, in Victorian England, treadmills were placed in prisons, and prisoners were forced to walk for hours each day on a treadmill as a form of mindless, meaningless punishment. Well, many people suffer from such a deep sense of meaninglessness that their life feels like a treadmill, constantly moving, but going nowhere, always busy, but producing nothing. Something is missing in our lives. And the irony is that there's nothing we can do. There's nothing we can buy, no earthly substitute that we can fill that sense of longing. We would like to see Jesus. We would like to see him because some of us have never experienced the peace that he truly brings. We need something to give our lives not only meaning, but also new vitality. We are empty. We are bored. And because we're empty and bored, we have no vitality, no zest, no drive. There's an energy crisis in our lives, and it has nothing to do with oil or nuclear power. It has to do with that inner emptiness. We are tired, listless, and apathetic. And what we need is a new heart, not a donated or man-made heart, but the heart that Jeremiah spoke of, heart that only seeing Jesus can give. William Gibson wrote in the book Mass for the Dead to honor his parents and their devotion to their children. In the book, Gibson tells how he grieved his mother and wanted so badly to understand the secret of her faith, which strengthened her in life and gave her peace and courage to face her death. So he took his mother's gold-rimmed glasses and faded prayer book, and he sat in her favorite chair. He opened the prayer book because he wanted to hear what she had heard. He put on her glasses because he wanted to see what she had seen. He sat in her place of prayer and devotion because he wanted to feel what she had felt. He wanted to experience what had so deeply centered and empowered her. But nothing happened. It did not work. And that's not too surprising. You see, he needed a faith of his own, not his mother's faith. William Gibson needed to see Jesus. That's what he was missing. It wasn't the chair or the prayer book or the glasses that shaped his mother's character or brought her such peace. It was her relationship with her Lord. Gibson's mother saw Jesus, and that truth shone from her life in such a way that it caused her son to crave that same experience. That's what all of us need, to see Jesus, and to know that he is real, and that he's with us in all of life's trials and tribulations and turmoil. And the good news is that it doesn't matter who we are or what we've done, no matter how much of a disaster our lives may seem to be, there is one who offers us more grace, more peace, more love than we could ever exhaust in a million lifetimes. Sir, we would like to see Jesus. We want to see Jesus so that we may obtain new meaning, new vitality, new possibilities, and the blessed assurance that we are never alone. Jesus truly is that way, the truth, and the life. No wonder we all long to see him, and we can see him. Through the eyes of faith, we can perceive him in our midst, to know that he's here, that he's with us today, this very moment. And so let us take new hope, new courage. Let us commit ourselves anew to his work, for we have beheld his glory, the glory is of the only begotten Son of the Father. As someone has so beautifully said, Christianity is not a philosophy that Jesus came to teach. It is a life that Jesus came to impart. And so to you, the people of God, it is my prayer that as we continue throughout these 40 days of Lent, may we receive in all of his fullness all that our Lord has for each and every one of us. For I pray it may be so. And all God's people said, Amen. God bless you. Till my ransom soul shall find.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The prayers of the Church. O God, with steadfast love you draw us to yourself, and in mercy you receive our prayers. Strengthen us to bring forth the fruits of the Spirit, that through life and death we may live in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Help us to manifest your loving spirit in all we are and all we wish to be. Help us to reestablish trusting and healthy relationships in our families, communities, and world. We lift up those who are ill, in poverty, grieving, weak, and weary, especially those who are dear to us at Grace. Bless Grace Diner, our sister churches in El Salvador, Los Angeles, and Compton, the Hope House, and all who live in it, our friends and neighbors, and all the supporters and volunteers of Grace Lutheran. Sustain us in our ministries to the poor, the lonely, and the homeless, and guide us to see and do your will until we join with you and all the saints in your everlasting kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And so we come to that part of the service that we are calling spiritual communion. Communion connects us not only with our Lord, but with all our loved ones, with all with whom we are in communion throughout all of history. That's what we mean by the communion of saints. So spiritual communion is a trust, and it's an awareness, a prayer, and an acceptance that God's love is really present, even when we can only be as present as our screens allow. God's grace can work through and transcend electronic communication. Through our spiritual communion, the reality of Jesus and the Father's love in and through the Holy Spirit is operating and present in our hearts and our minds. And so I invite you to pray this prayer with me. I believe that you are truly present in the sacrament of Holy Communion. O Lord, I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot receive you in the sacrament of your body and blood, come spiritually into my heart. Cleanse and strengthen me with your grace, Lord Jesus. Let me never be separated from you. O Lord, may I live in you and you in me, in this life and in the life to come. And all God's people said, Amen. And so, folks, remember that you are in our love and in our prayers. And again, if you need anything, please feel free to email us or call the church office, leave a message, and we will get back to you. And so receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, Amen. God bless you.
My children, with my blessing now. children.